Okay, I got a message from a from someone watching this interview closely. He wants to know what for you is the selling proposition of Mayor Isko Moreno in this campaign.
What could be or what he is doing?
What is the selling proposition?
When you look at his pronouncement, which is that bilis kilos. No? But again, it might be over-analysis on my part. Has it really translated below? Maybe that's what he's lacking. He speaks of a 10-point agenda that is based on things that he has achieved in Manila. But is it really something that he is selling, and is it reaching the voters, or is it simply an analyst like me?
Okay.
Understands, because you review different posturing and positioning of candidates.
Okay.
Because speaking of, I don't think it's reflecting voters yet. It's hitting the voters yet.
Okay. Speaking of efficient communication strategies, how come in the case of Senator Manny Pacquiao and in this case, Mayor Isko Moreno, objectively speaking, we've seen them, we've heard them talk in detail about what they intend to do if they are elected president during campaign sorties, even during interviews in the national media. On the other hand, I think it would also be reasonable to compare their communication strategies and their detailed political platforms or campaign platforms with that of former Senator Bongbong Marcos, the overriding message of which is unity, but we don't see or hear much details. So bakit effective doon kay Bongbong, but dito sa dalaw hindi?
Something that we track in an institute is data analytics. You know, Marcos, Senator Marcos, even hit a high of 60% dominance in social media, while Isko Moreno was less than 5%. Pacquiao was 3%. So if you are treating all these candidates equally in mainstream media, where is the niche? The niche is in that social media, which I think is now becoming the dominant second source of information for candidates. TV is still number one, but after that, used to be radio. But I think we have seen the rise of social media, and we're hitting, what, 89 to 92 million Filipinos in social media. So you create that niche. And that is where I find campaign of Isko Moreno and Manny Pacquiao lacking.
Now, given that situation that you just described, and given the numbers of former Senator Bongbong Marcos, do you think he has reached the point that he can basically ignore the mainstream media and just focus his campaign on social media?
He could ignore, or he is ignoring mainstream media, except if he's comfortable. So now the challenge is for mainstream media to define the issues of this campaign. Mr. Marcos has successfully framed the debate, tell his story. That is what campaigns are for. So it's up for mainstream media now to put up the challenge. If you feel that you're being set aside, and because when you look at the campaign of Senator Marcos, maybe they're saying on their part, we're simply going straight to the voters. But the problem with going straight to the voters is that it lacks the what we call the discipline of fact-checking, the discipline of telling what's true or simply campaign stories.
And the candidate can basically just lie to his favor, right? Because
it could be that way also. That's why, again, it's why when you talk of political system, we always tell people that for a democracy to work, you need to create that that environment where independent media is there, independent government institutions are there, to ensure that there's ways to control possible disinformation happening in the political arena.
Okay. I saw a figure circulating in social media claiming that based on this same SWS survey, the trust rating of Isko Moreno is at 70%, which was higher than Bongbong Marcos's 64%. How do you explain that, given the fact that it's Bongbong Marcos leading the survey?
That's a positive news if you can build on that trust, because we have data in previous years that shows that people would like a second characteristics, honesty and trustworthiness. That's very important. But that is just a first. That means how do you translate that and convert that trustworthiness? Then you need to speak of who you are and reach more. I think what's wrong, as I've said, with the Mayor East Coast campaigns, when you focus on the use of television, you fail to see the new trend, whereby social media is a way to be more targeted, targeting specific demographics and reaching them more. Okay. And maybe he needs to communicate more on that area.
What do you think of the way Mayor Isko Moreno has been handling this this issue regarding his running mate, Dr. Willie Ong? The fact that his own campaign manager admitted in the same program that it was his call to ask Dr. Willie Ong not to join the Mindanao sortie of Mayor Isko Moreno, where they were expecting some heavy fire in favor of Sara Duterte because supporters supposedly were pushing for an Isko Moreno-Sara Duterte tandem. Of course, later on, Mayor Isko Moreno clarified that he would stick with Dr. Willie Ong, but there was silence before that game.
That's why I've said that's the challenge with Senator Mayor Isko, the way he moves from these issues. That was also the issue last year. Is he independent or is he pro-Duterte? So now is it Willie Ong? So those are things that maybe, though he's trusted, if I'll relate it to your earlier question, he really needs to define himself. And if you're a vice presidential candidate like a Willie Ong and you see that maybe I am of no value anymore, maybe you can best help your candidate by saying, I would like now to simply step down and help my mayor become president.
But wouldn't that also affect Mayor Isko Moreno negatively because he could also be seen as... Okay, this is not in the context of Dr. Willie Ong, but from the other perspective that people might see this as a negative attribute of Senate of Mayor Isko Moreno, that he lacks loyalty and commitment to his own running mate, that he might be seen as an opportunist.
The reality of a personality-driven campaigns is that there are strategic values if you see after a few weeks, in this case, nearly a month of campaigning, actual official campaigning. So that's why for me, at times, if there's really no reason to have a vice president instead of simply carrying one, it makes you more flexible. But I really don't know. We're all watching from outside. So it's really surprising what we saw in Mindanao. The only thing I saw value to that is really the strength of the Duterte name in Mindanao.
Yeah, and it's also the problem with our system where we don't have tandem voting. We vote the president and the vice president separately.
And the weak party system makes you really drop.
Now, that push for Sara Duterte vice presidency other than a Bongbong Marcos presidency. We also saw that in parts of the Bicol region in the case of Vice President Leni Robredo. Yes. There were also those who were pushing for a Leni Robredo-Sara Duterte tandem. Now, my question is, didn't that also somehow indicate that even this so-called solid support for Bongbong Marcos was actually not exactly solid, that it's a myth since many of his supporters or perceived supporters are actually pushing for someone else to be in tandem with their preferred vice presidential candidate?
Always remember, those who are endorsing are local political leaders. They are simply endorsing, but are the voters following them? Of course, we will only know by May 9. But right now, we can only see, because all these things were moving during February. Will this reflect in February surveys? It would be good to see. Where would Bongbong be in Bicol or Southern Luzon with all these movements? Or where will Isko Moreno be in Mindanao with this so-called Isko Sara initiative by some campaigns?
Okay, Mr. Dinduman Hit, thank you very much for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you.
We're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.